Thank you. You may be seated. The wonderful peace of God that passes all understanding. And it's ours in the midst of all the hectic turmoil and chaos and confusion of life, because we find our peace in Christ. Peace I leave with you, my peace I give unto you. Not as the world giveth, give I unto you. Our text tonight is Acts chapter 6, still looking at verses 6 through 10. There was a mistake in the bulletin this morning. We're still looking at divine direction tonight as part number 6. Before we do that, let's look to the Lord in prayer. Our gracious Heavenly Father, how we thank you that you do indeed give us your divine direction. And Father, as day by day we seek to walk by faith instead of by sight, that direction guides us very clearly through your word. We pray that you will grant grace and understanding to each one of us, so that as we examine our motives in life and as we seek to do your will, that we might be squarely in the center of your will, not only following what you want us to do, but being filled with joy and peace in knowing that we are doing it. And so, Father, we commit this time to you tonight and pray for your blessings upon it, for we pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. Beginning in verse 6. Now when they had gone throughout Phrygia and the region of Galatia, and were forbidden of the Holy Ghost to preach the word in Asia, after they were come to Mysia, they essayed to go into Bithynia, but the Spirit suffered them not. And they, passing by Mysia, came down to Troas. And a vision appeared to Paul in the night. There stood a man of Macedonia and prayed him, saying, Come over into Macedonia and help us. And after he had seen the vision, immediately we endeavored to go into Macedonia, assuredly gathering that the Lord had called us for to preach the gospel unto them. You recall that 2 weeks ago, as we looked at part 5, and then last week with Brother Paul Durand, our missionary speaker, we've talked about in the past, in the first 4 or 5 sessions, the will of God and practical application. We discussed the Bible as foundational for knowing the will of God, and we discussed knowing the will of God for our lives personally. We asked 4 questions, very important questions to ask when trying to discover what is God's will for my life. As we search the scripture, we ask these questions. Number 1, does the passage apply directly to me in knowing the will of God, or does it rather, number 2, establish some principle? Or number 3, does it give an illustration that I'm supposed to follow? Or number 4, does it show a difference between Israel and the church? And we went through an extended passage in Leviticus about all the unclean meats and saw that obviously they don't apply directly to us. It does establish the principle of separation. But we find that in the New Testament, the Apostle Paul tells us that every creature of God is good, and nothing can be refused if it be received with thanksgiving, for it is sanctified by the word of God in prayer. 4 questions that we can begin with as we begin that search for the will of God. And that brought us to the next major area in discerning God's will for our lives, which is the will of God and motivation. The will of God and motivation. We have to ask ourselves, the next question is, why am I doing what I am doing? You see, the will of God includes the reasons that we do what we do. We might be doing something externally that looks good, but our motivation for it is wrong, and therefore it is clearly outside the will of God. It may look good on the surface, but our motivation may be a sinful motivation for doing it. Like the young man who wants to court a young lady, and so he goes and makes a very impressive appearance before her father and talks to him very courteously and graciously and brings flowers to the young lady and invites her out to dinner, and with the parents' approval goes out to dinner. Now it all seems very much appropriate, and though that's the right way to do it, the young man has the wrong motivation in doing it. He has the design of seduction. You see, just the surface is not what's most important. What is underneath the surface is also extremely important. And so we are discussing the motivations for what we do and why we do it. We talked about our first positive motive, and that is doing things so that God will be glorified. That means we have to be motivated without mixture of carnal reasons for doing what we're doing. And frankly, that's quite hard to do in the flesh. You can't do it unless you are doing that in the power of the Holy Spirit. And we saw many passages exhorting us that this must be our principal motive in every area of life. Do all for the glory of God. We saw that in the area of food. For example, 1 Corinthians 10:31, whether therefore you eat or drink or whatsoever you do, do it all to the glory of God. That really covers everything. Or in the area of thanksgiving, 2 Corinthians 4:15, for all things are for your sakes, that the abundant grace might, through the thanksgiving of many, redound to the glory of God. Or in our speech, Philippians 2:11, and that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Every area of our life ultimately comes back to that issue, is our motive, so that ultimately God will receive the maximum amount of glory. In the past, we also have discussed things that are neither moral nor immoral in themselves. In other words, independently, without any context, they're neutral. And we had a special word for those things. It's a technical term. It's the word adiaphorus. Adiaphorus. It's neither moral nor immoral in and of itself, but placed in a context, it can become moral or immoral. For example, you have a choice if you want to wear a red shirt or a green shirt. Without a context, that's neutral. But in the context of being seen, you're a parade of communists or a parade of tree huggers, it might take on a definite meaning of identification. So certain things may be in and of themselves neutral, and most folks who argue that this is a neutral activity that I'm doing are arguing that because they want it to be neutral in the context in which they place it, where it may take on some very inappropriate or appropriate moral or immoral meanings. Adiaphorus. 2 weeks ago, we discussed the will of God, and we began our study of false motives. If you have false motives for doing what you're doing, you are not glorifying God, and therefore you are not doing the will of God. We talked about what is a man or a woman called who has false motive for doing what they're doing, and we saw what Jesus said. When thou prayest, thou shalt not be as the hypocrites are. See, they have a false motive for praying. They love to pray standing in the synagogues and in the corners of the street, that they may be seen of men. Verily I say unto you, they have the reward. But Matthew 23:5, all their works they do for to be seen of men. They make broad their phylacteries and enlarge the borders of their garments. Jesus called them hypocrites. Hypocrisy is the first evil false motive. And as I noted at that point, that's sort of a catch-all motive that's manifested by many of the other evil motives. Hypocrisy is sort of the undergirding foundation of all the other false motives in our lives. The glory of God is the undergirding foundation for all of the good motives for doing what we should be doing to the glory of God. And so we move tonight to the second evil motive, which is pride. Now, with hypocrisy, we looked at 31 different passages dealing with the multifaceted manifestations of hypocrisy. But within that context, we saw the evil motive, the second one, which is pride. So we need to ask ourselves the question, am I motivated to do what I am doing, or what I am thinking, or what I am saying by pride? If the answer is yes, we are not fulfilling the will of God for our lives. The wicked, through pride of his countenance, will not seek after God. God is not in all his thoughts, Psalm 10:4. What that does is it undercuts all the proper motives for doing something, because God is not in his thoughts. You see, pride is the sin of the devil. Satan tried to eliminate God, tried to move God out of the way. Isaiah chapter 14 gives to us the five great I wills of Satan, for which God cast him out of heaven. Proverbs 8:13, the fear of the Lord is to hate evil. Pride and arrogancy and the evil way and the froward mouth do I hate. That's what God says about it. Proverbs 11:2, when pride cometh, then cometh shame, but with the lowly is wisdom. We think that pride is going to accomplish what we want. But God says, I'll guarantee it, since it's not my will for your life, that it will bring you, instead of the glory that you wanted, it will bring you to shame. Proverbs 13:10, only by pride cometh contention, but with the well-advised is wisdom. If the motive for what you're doing or saying is pride, the only thing that results is a fight. That doesn't bring glory to God. Proverbs 14:3, in the mouth of the foolish is a rod of pride, but the lips of the wise shall preserve them. Pride manifests itself not merely by the way we carry ourselves, the bearing that we deport, but it comes out of our mouths. In the mouth of the foolish is a rod of pride. And the rod is something that beats and destroys. Proverbs 16:18, pride goeth before destruction, and an haughty spirit before a fall. Pride will not get you where you want to go, to the top. Pride instead will bring you to the very bottom. Proverbs 29:23, a man's pride shall bring him low, but honor shall uphold the humble in spirit. You want to be up? Get rid of pride. And then we find a man who experienced that problem and saw the results from the hand of God. Daniel 4:37. Now I, Nebuchadnezzar, praise and extol and honor the King of heaven, all whose works are truth and his ways judgment. And those that walk in pride, he is able to abase. You know, our Lord Jesus Christ gave to us a list of various evil motives, including pride, all of which stem from the heart. And some of the things in the list are motivational sins, such as pride, and others are simply expressive sins. But let me give it to you. It's in the Gospel of Mark, chapter 7, verses 21 through 23. For from within, out of the heart of men, proceed evil thoughts, adulteries, fornications, murders, thefts, covetousness, wickedness, deceit, lasciviousness, an evil eye, blasphemy, and here it is, pride, foolishness. All these evil things come from within and defile the man. Some of those are motivational sins, such as we're talking about tonight. The reasons that we do certain things that we do. Other things are sins of action. Sins that we commit because of our motivational sins. Pride is deadly in church leadership. Paul tells us in 1 Timothy 3:6, not a novice, lest being lifted up with pride, he fall into the condemnation of the devil. And he's taking you back there to Isaiah 14 when he gives you that statement. The sin of pride is deadly in the life of any believer and definitely means that he or she is not in the will of God. 1 John 2:16, for all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh and the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life is not of the Father, but is of the world. And the world passeth away in the lusts thereof, but he that doeth, and here we have it, the will of God abideth forever. It's one of the three things that keep you out of the will of God. The lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, the pride of life. None of those are ever from the Father. If you are doing those things, you are not in the will of the Father. But he that doeth the will of God abideth forever. A deadly sin in the life of every believer, and all of us face it at various times. The third evil motive is covetousness. We need to ask ourselves, am I motivated to do what I am doing, thinking, or saying by covetousness or by greed? If the answer is yes, I'm not fulfilling the will of God in my life. For example, ask yourself this question. Why do I hoard all the stuff that I hoard. Why do I hoard all the stuff that I hoard? It's hard for us to answer that question honestly, I think, because all of us have deep down within us the desire to hoard stuff. Remember what we just read in 1 John, the world passes away. You can't take any of it with you. Only the things that you can use for the glory of God are worth having. Only the things that you are actually using for the glory of God are worth having. What is your motivation? If your motivation behind what you are accumulating is so that you might use it for the glory of God, and then in fact you do, rather than just lying to yourself and saying, well, I'm doing this because I want to use it for the glory of God, covetousness, it will keep you out of the center of the will of God. Look at it in the context of motivation with Psalm 119:36. Incline my heart unto thy testimonies and not to covetousness. It's set in direct opposition to the testimonies of God, that is, the Word of God. Psalm 119 is the chapter dealing with the Word of God. Listen to the practical results in Proverbs 28, verse 16. The prince that wanteth understanding is also a great oppressor, but he that hateth covetousness shall prolong his days. We think that by hoarding all that stuff and then spending every night worrying about what's going to happen to it, that's what's going to give us real life. Did you know that'll shorten your life? The man who hates covetousness, according to Scripture, will prolong his days. How about Jeremiah 6:13? This is some sin that affects people at every level of life, whether you're down at the bottom or whether you're at the top. For from the least of them, even unto the greatest of them, every one is given to covetousness. And from the prophet, even unto the priest, everyone dealeth falsely. It's tied together with being crooked. We want things that are so much, we want those things that we're willing to cheat to get them. You'll notice that every one of these motivational sins is also tied into certain sins of action as we go through the various passages of Scripture related to each one of those motivations. How about Ezekiel 33:31? And they come unto thee as the people cometh, and they sit before thee as my people, and they hear thy words. So here they are. The congregation is gathered. They want to hear what Ezekiel has to say next. They want to see what kind of antics Ezekiel's going to do, what kind of things, as we talked about this morning, that he's going to symbolize for them with the different actions that he's doing. They come before you. They sit before you as my people. They hear your words, but they will not do them. Do you know what keeps them from obeying? They understood what Ezekiel was saying. They understood the parables that he was enacting for them. But we're told the reason that they wouldn't obey. For with their mouth they show much love, but their heart goeth after their covetousness. It's a deadly sin. It's a motivational sin. It is a motivational sin that will keep us from being in the center of the will of God. Jesus puts it in the list of various sins that we've seen just a moment ago, where we saw pride. It's in that list in Mark 7:22. Thefts, covetousness, wickedness, deceit, lasciviousness, an evil eye, blasphemy, pride, foolishness. But Jesus didn't just put it in a list. He also gave us warnings about pride. Luke 12:15, and he said unto them, take heed and beware of covetousness, for a man's life consisteth not in the abundance of the things which he possesseth. Back to that old sin nature tendency that we all have to hoard stuff. I don't remember how many years ago it was. It was a long time ago. But Imelda Marcos was the wife of the president of the Philippines. And when she passed away, they found that she had over 3,000 pairs of shoes. Folks, wearing them one a day, that would take you 10 years to wear 3,000 pairs of shoes. Why are we doing what we do? Is it so that it will bring glory to God? Or is it for one of these false motives that prod us forward, and here are the reasons we're doing these things? The Apostle Paul tells us this in Romans 1:29. He's discussing the reprobates, and he says, being filled with all unrighteousness, fornication, wickedness, covetousness, maliciousness, full of envy, murder, debate, deceit, malignity, whisperers. Squarely in the midst of that list of fornicators and murderers is covetousness. We're warned against it as believers, Ephesians 5:3. But fornication and all uncleanness, or covetousness. Look at the context that covetousness is stuck in. Fornication and uncleanness. Let it not be once named among you as become a saints. That's something that is very unbecoming to those who are called by God saints. Those who have been set apart for the holy service of our Lord Jesus Christ. Ephesians 5:5. Listen to it carefully, because it tells you the category into which God places covetousness. Even as we saw this morning, the category of witchcraft and idolatry connected to stubbornness and to rebellion. Listen to this. For this ye know, that no whoremonger, nor unclean person, nor covetous man, who is an idolater, hath any inheritance in the kingdom of Christ and of God. Rebellion is as a sin of witchcraft, and stubbornness as iniquity and idolatry. Here the covetous man is specifically called an idolater. He has set up a different God in his life. How can you be in the center of God's will if you have a different God on the throne? In case we missed it, Paul says it again in the book of Colossians. Colossians 3:5. Mortify therefore your members which are upon the earth. Fornication, uncleanness, inordinate affection, evil concupiscence, and here's the only one that he gives a descriptive term for, and covetousness, which is idolatry. Why do you hoard the things? I should ask myself the question. Why do I hoard the things which I hoard? Is it for the glory of God? Or is there some deeper false motive that I'm covering over, which in fact means that in those areas I'm not doing the will of God because it is not for His glory? Hebrews 13:5. Let your conversation, and that's the word for your manner of life, the way that you live, let your conversation be without covetousness, and be content with such things as ye have, for he hath said, I will never leave thee nor forsake thee. What more do we need? With food and raiment, let us be therewith content. And Jesus promised himself, I will never leave thee nor forsake thee. At the end of his ministry, he told the disciples, "Lo, I am with you always. Let your conversation be without covetousness." There's one other serious issue that relates to covetousness, and we see that covetousness is a mark of the apostates. Oh, we all joke about those TV preachers that get up there and flash their rings like Father Divine used to do, and he'd stick his hands up in front of the cameras and their gold and diamonds all over them, and he'd say, "You see this gold? You paid for this gold." 2 Peter 2:3. "And through covetousness shall they with feigned words make merchandise of you." They don't give, they sell you. "They make merchandise of you, whose judgment now of a long time lingereth not, and their damnation slumbereth not. Let not covetousness be once named among you as become a saint," because covetousness is the mark of an apostate. That brings us to the fourth evil motive in our lives. Things that will definitely keep us from being in the center of God's will, that will definitely not enable us to fulfill doing all to the glory of God. And the fourth evil motive is sloth. I need to ask myself, am I motivated to do what I'm doing, thinking, or saying by sloth? If the answer is yes, I'm not fulfilling the will of God for my life. For example, am I resting because I have worked hard and my body needs to recover, or am I resting because I'm a lazy bum and I'd rather not work right now? You know, that's a hard question to answer honestly also, because all of us can make an excuse for why we're just lounging around on the couch and watching a TV program or popping chocolates in our mouth, or while we're just fooling around and not doing what we know we ought to be doing. Am I motivated to do what I'm doing, thinking, or saying by sloth? Proverbs 19:15, "Slothfulness casteth into a deep sleep, and an idle soul shall suffer hunger." Ecclesiastes 10:18, "By much slothfulness the building decayeth, and through idleness of the hands the house droppeth through." Or Proverbs 6:6, "Go to the ant, thou sluggard, consider her ways and be wise." Or verse 9, "How long wilt thou sleep, O sluggard? When wilt thou arise out of thy sleep?" For I love Proverbs 10:26, "As vinegar to the teeth and as smoke to the eyes, so is the sluggard to them that send him." How many times have you given an assignment to someone to do, and they dragged their feet, and they dragged their feet, and they dragged their feet? Those of you who are parents have been through this. I know you have. Many times over the course of the more than 40 years that we raise children, still raising some, we've given an assignment to the kids to do, and we come back 10 minutes later and it hasn't been started yet. And there's a good reason for it, of course. We come back 30 minutes later and it still hasn't been started, but after all, this problem came up. We come back an hour later and they're daydreaming. "Oh, I forgot." Have you ever done that? Or you know there's something you need to get done and you just don't get around to it. Years ago, I had a little wooden coin, and on it were printed in capital letters four letters, T-U-I-T. And so when someone would say to you, "I'll do it when I get around to it," I'd say, "Here is a round to it." Sloth. That will keep you from the will of God, because you're not merely wasting time, you're wasting your life. And when I'm a sloth, I'm not merely wasting time, I'm wasting my life. Time is the stuff of which life is made. And every moment that goes by is bringing us closer and closer and closer to the point of death. We don't know when it'll happen. That has been impressed on me so painfully with Judy's death. It comes suddenly. And sloth is the sin of motivation that is designed not merely to reduce our ability to give glory to God, but it definitely reduces the number of heavenly rewards that we will gain for serving Christ. It's a painful motivation. As vinegar to the teeth, as smoke to the eyes, so is the sluggard to them that send him. You know, when you get a big swig of vinegar, what does it do to your mouth? It goes, oh. Or, you know, you're by a campfire and suddenly the wind changes and the smoke blows into your eyes and there's pain and tears run down your face. If you're a sluggard, if I'm a sluggard, that's the way we affect the people around us. The soul of the sluggard desireth and hath nothing, but the soul of the diligent shall be made fat. The sluggard will not plow by reason of the cold, therefore shall he beg in harvest and have nothing. The sluggard is wiser in his own conceit than seven men that can render a reason. I have a relative, I'll not tell you who, somewhat distant relative, who is one of the laziest people I have ever known in my life. He has never, in his entire adult life, held down a job for more than a week or two. He fiddles around with this and he fiddles around with that, and he's been back to school 15 or 20 times, always studying something different because maybe he has the idea that he'll be this or that or the other thing. And now he's reaching almost old age. And he's never done anything. His wife supports him. A very diligent woman. And you know, if you ever talk to him about it, this verse describes him perfectly. The sluggard is wiser in his own conceit than seven men that can render a reason. Proverbs 12:24. The hand of the diligent shall bear rule, but the slothful shall be under tribute. 12:27. The slothful man roasteth not that which he took in hunting, but the substance of a diligent man is precious. There are several verses that deal with that issue in Scripture. Hey, it's fun to go hunting. It is no fun to skin the animal and drain the blood and cut it in pieces and cook the pieces before you eat it. But it's a thrill to get out there and hide in the blind, and boy, when that buck comes into sight and you raise your .30-06 up there and you get him in the sights and you pull the trigger and get him right behind his left shoulder and he drops in one step, man, what the thrill of the hunt is. The sluggard roasteth not that which he took in hunting, but the substance of a diligent man is precious. The diligent man says, that's meat for my family. And there's a parallel verse to it in Proverbs 18:9. He also that is slothful in his work is brother to him that is a great waster. One of the things that is very painful to me, because I have lived for many years throughout my life with having almost nothing, I hate to see waste. Because everything is precious, sometimes merely for survival, and someday that may happen here in the United States. It's happened in other civilized countries around the world where there was not enough to eat. And the people who are the wasters will be the people who starve. Book of Proverbs says, he also that is slothful in his work is brother to him that is a great waster. Proverbs 21:5, the thoughts of the diligent tend only to plenteousness, but of everyone that is hasty only to want. Did you catch the point of that verse? The mental attitude precedes the physical action. The thoughts of the diligent The New Testament tells us that we need to bring every thought into captivity to Christ. Our thought life precedes our actions. Our thoughts in the area of sloth precede our inaction. Proverbs 22:29. Seest thou a man diligent in his business? He shall stand before kings. He shall not stand before mean men. Sloth is going to put you at the bottom. Diligence will put you at the top. Say, okay, give me some New Testament verses. All right, how about 2 Peter 3:14? Here Peter applies this principle to our spiritual lives. Wherefore, beloved, seeing that ye look for such things, be diligent that you may be found of him in peace, without spot, and blameless. Sloth versus diligence in the spiritual life. The fifth evil motive is gluttony. I need to ask myself, am I motivated to do what I am doing, thinking, or saying by gluttony? If the answer is yes, I'm not fulfilling the will of God for my life. Because remember what Paul said? Whatsoever you eat or drink, do all to the glory of God. Gluttony is eating and drinking, but not for the glory of God, but for the indulgence of the flesh. As a matter of fact, it was part of the statement that parents had to make when their son was an evil boy who needed to be killed by stoning. Listen to Deuteronomy 21:20. They shall say unto the elders of his city, this our son is stubborn and rebellious. We talked about that this morning, like the sin of idolatry, like the sin of witchcraft, which was tied into covetousness just a few moments ago. This our son is stubborn and rebellious. He will not obey our voice. Listen to the last part of the verse. He is a glutton and a drunkard. And then all the elders of the city gather around, and they take stones, and they stone him to death. Now, God could have listed a whole bunch of other sins in there. Like I said, well, our son is stubborn and rebellious, and he's been running around committing immorality. Or our son is stubborn and rebellious, and he's running around and stealing stuff from people. Interesting what was connected to the stubborn and rebellious son. He hadn't brought his body into subjection. He hadn't disciplined himself, as the Apostle Paul says that we're supposed to do with our bodies, because our body is the temple of the Holy Spirit who lives within us. He's stubborn and rebellious, and what has that resulted in? He's gluttonous and he's a drunkard. Proverbs 23:21, for the drunkard and the glutton shall come to poverty, and drowsiness shall clothe a man with rags. There's an interesting verse in Proverbs, in Psalm 119:70. Speaking in contrast of the wicked and the righteous in relation to the Word of God, he says, their heart is fat as grease, but I delight in thy law. Gluttony is compared to idolatry in Romans and 1 Corinthians and Philippians. Listen to these verses, Romans 16:18. For they that are such serve not our Lord Jesus Christ, but their own belly, and by good words and fair speeches deceive the heart of the simple. They serve their own belly. 1 Corinthians 6:13, meats for the belly and the belly for meats, but God shall destroy both it and them. Now the body is not for fornication, but for the Lord, and the Lord for the body. He compares gluttony there with fornication. Philippians 3:19, whose end is destruction, whose God is their belly, and whose glory is in their shame, who mind earthly things. The sixth evil motive is anger. There is a godly righteous anger where it is an anger against sin. Be angry and sin not. But the majority of our anger is not godly anger. So I need to ask myself, am I motivated to do what I am doing, thinking, or saying by anger? If the answer is yes, I'm not fulfilling the will of God for my life. You can see this in your children. I've seen it in some of my children. Some are more prone to it than others. They get angry because you've told them to do something, or perhaps even because you've spanked them and perhaps not spanked them hard enough. And they stamp their foot and they get mad, and you can tell right away that they're not going to do it because they are mad. You see it in the church. Somebody gets mad at the preacher. I'm not coming back there anymore because I'm mad at him. Now, there are reasons not to come to a church. If the preacher is preaching false doctrine, you don't go to the church. If the preacher or church leadership is involved in immorality, you don't go to the church. If they're compromising with the world, the flesh, and the devil, you don't go to the church. But if you're merely mad at them because of something they preached, and it was true, and so you're just not going to do it until they decide not to do that anymore, because you don't like to hear that subject, be careful. You're not in the will of God. It's so easy for us to take our own, may I say, petty, personal wants and desires and exalt them to the level of where everything must conform to our personal wants and desires. And if it doesn't, we get mad. Dear people, that will keep you from the center of God's will. For example, in the context of the church, forsake not the assembling of yourselves together as the manner of some is, but exhort one another, and so much the more as you see the day approaching. That's not a reason to leave church, and certainly not to leave church entirely, though there have been many who have done so. Some of the verses, Proverbs 15:1. The soft answer turneth away wrath, but grievous words stir up anger. A wrathful man stirreth up strife, but he that is slow to anger appeaseth strife. He that is slow to anger is better than the mighty, and he that ruleth his spirit than he that taketh a city. Isn't that amazing? That was written back in the days of warfare, where the big heroes would go up against the city, they would storm the gate, they would break down the walls, and they would conquer the city. Proverbs 16:32 says, he that is slow to anger is better than the mighty. He that ruleth his spirit than he that taketh a city. The control of anger is part of wisdom. Proverbs 19:11, the discretion of a man deferreth his anger, and it is his glory to pass over a transgression. It says something about our spiritual maturity when we're able to control our anger. If there are times when we should be exercising anger, such as in the discipline of a child, if we're involved in moral sin, it means that our anger will not take the effect that it should. Listen to Proverbs 22:8. He that soweth iniquity, that's moral sin, shall reap vanity, and the rod of his anger shall fail. How many fathers have tried to discipline their children, but the father is secretly involved in immorality? And he doesn't understand why, when he's trying to do what the Bible says about spanking his kid, there's no response in the kid. It's because there is a sin in the life of the parent. Proverbs 27:4, wrath is cruel, anger is outrageous, but who is able to stand before envy? We'll be talking about envy later on. Ecclesiastes 7:9, be not hasty in thy spirit to be angry, for anger resteth in the bosom of fools. Dear people, if that's your motivation behind doing something, not only are you not in the center of the will of God, you're going to get even. You're mad about this. God says, anger rests in the bosom of fools. What a terrible motivation to keep us out of the center of the will of God. Proverbs 12:16, a fool's wrath is presently known, but a prudent man covereth shame. 14:29, he that is slow to wrath is of great understanding, but he that is hasty of spirit exalteth folly. See, a lot of the times when we get mad about something, it's because we don't have all the facts. And if we had all the facts, it would diffuse the situation. That's why it says, he that is slow to wrath is of great understanding, but he that is hasty of spirit exalteth folly. And one I know that you know is Proverbs 15:1, a soft answer turneth away wrath, but grievous words stir up anger. Proverbs 19:19, a man of great wrath shall suffer punishment, for if thou deliver him, yet thou must do it again. Oh, I had a situation 35 years ago. Now, about 35 years ago, I was pastoring another church, and I had a young man come to church. He and his wife, they were set up in business by his parents, who were quite wealthy, had two little kids. And he was a very proud young man, but he was also a young man who was a very angry young man. And after I dealt with him for quite a while, this is the verse that came to my mind. A man of great wrath shall suffer punishment, for if thou deliver him, yet thou must do it again. He enjoyed hot rodding. And he kept getting picked up for it. And I kept having to come down and bail him out. You deliver him, you have to deliver him again. And he was always mad at the police. Always mad at them. It was their fault. It wasn't his fault. I mean, I tried to help that young family so many times. I fixed their doors. I fixed their washing machines. Tried to show him how to do certain things. He never learned. Sadly, in the end, his wife divorced him. She couldn't put up with his constant outbursts and anger. Proud and haughty scorner is his name who dealeth in proud wrath. A stone is heavy, the sand is weighty, but a fool's wrath is heavier than them both. Wrath is cruel and anger is outrageous, but who is able to stand before envy? Surely the churning of milk bringeth forth butter, and the wringing of the nose bringeth forth blood. So the forcing of wrath bringeth forth strife. Say, okay, let's hear some from the New Testament. All right. Galatians chapter 5, the works of the flesh. Idolatry, witchcraft, hatred, variance, emulation, wrath, strife, seditions, heresy. The same context as idolatry and witchcraft, which we've already talked about. And heresies, we've talked about the apostates. And strife, we've talked about that. And hatred, and divisions, which is variances. The New Testament command to us, Colossians 3:8. But now ye also put off all these. And what are the first two? Anger, wrath, malice, blasphemy, filthy communications out of your mouth. Anger, wrath, and malice head the list. 1 Timothy 2:8. I will therefore that men pray everywhere, lifting up holy hands without wrath and doubting. Why do you pray for what you pray for? God smiting dad. He did this bad thing to me. I hope you rip him up. Give him leprosy. Lifting up holy hands without wrath and doubting. We know that we're supposed to pray in faith. That takes care of the doubting. What's the other thing we're not supposed to do when we pray? Without wrath. That's the lifting up of the holy hands, without wrath, without doubting. James 1:19-20. Wherefore, my beloved brethren, let every man be swift to hear, slow to speak, slow to wrath. For the wrath of man worketh not the righteousness of God. We're to do all to the glory of God. That's supposed to be our primary motive for being in the center of God's will, doing the will of God by bringing Him glory. The wrath of man worketh not the righteousness of God. Well, our time is up. We still have two more to go. So the Lord willing, we'll pick it up there next week. Our gracious Heavenly Father, it is so easy for us to walk in the flesh. It's always there. Unless we're armed and faithfully paying attention to your word, suddenly we find that the devil has, or the flesh, very easily pulled us outside of the will of God because we're doing things which may look good on the surface, but we're doing them for the wrong reasons. Our motivation is tainted by the flesh. And when we're walking in the flesh, we are not walking in the Spirit. And if we're not walking in the Spirit, we're not walking in the center of God's will. Father, we pray that you'll take your word as proclaimed tonight. We've gone through many, many verses with hardly commentary on any of them. But to get the impact, the overview of these motivational sins, which drag us into the physical sins, the mental sins, the sins of speech, the sins of attitude, these motivational sins that keep us from doing everything to the glory of God. Father, we can argue all we want about how hard it is, but you have given us your indwelling Holy Spirit, who by your grace enables us to do your will, enables us to crush the flesh, enable us to say no when those sins of motive raise their ugly sneering heads. Father, we pray that you will take your word, impact our hearts and our minds, that our motives before you might be pure, that we might do all to the glory of God. For we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.